for an even warmer one. Anyway, if we haven't met, I'm Ann Bogart. I'm one of the three artistic directors of City Company. And this is the final event of the symposium we've held for the last 3 days. I'm speaking now to people who don't know what the hell you're doing here. You just showed up. It's been called Transformation Through Training. And I think the more we've gone through these days together, it's been clearly exactly those words, transformation through training. I think all of us have felt the impact of what this training has meant, what Suzuki's influence is, and it's been very moving. I mean, at one point, I think, Barney, where's Barney again? Yeah, at the last symposium, you looked up at Ellen and you said, thank you for this. That's a company member speaking after 25 years, so that's really extraordinary. So welcome for those who don't know what you're doing here. This is a conversation with Suzuki Tadashi, and after which we'll be doing a little bit of a closing ceremony for this symposium. But I just want to first of all thank you for being here this morning. And is there anything housekeeping-wise I need to say? Where's Megan?
Yeah.
This is the most important part of what I have to say, which is welcome to HowlRound. We are being live streamed right now, and so there are people who are not in the room who are in the room in a very different way. We're trying to learn what that means to be in the room and not in the room at the same time. So this is part of that attempt to understand that. So welcome to HowlRound. Welcome to those who are watching. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce you, and I'm going to tell you first, Cameron Steele, who has been with Suzuki for a long time, he's going to be translating. And Mr. Suzuki and Cameron, please come on stage. Thank you. Describe to you personally what Suzuki's work has meant to me, certainly to the company, but also I'd like to start by speaking personally. And in this little anecdote that I'd like to share with you, there are a series of questions which you will understand. Was it 1992 or 1993? I can't remember, the first year that City Company went to Togamura, way up, as most of you know, in the far reaches of the mountains north of Toyama in Japan. And we brought with us, it was the inaugural season of City Company. It was Suzuki's idea originally to start City Company. He proposed it to me in a hotel lobby in the Mayflower Hotel. Do you remember? It's now a Trump hotel. I'm very sorry to say. And we brought with us, as the first production, it was a production of Orestes by Chuck Mead. And we were very happily in Togo, rehearsing away, everything was going fine, you know, rehearsing. Rehearsing has its problems and its joys. And one day, we were about to have our first run-through, and we were at lunch. And Suzuki asked me if he could come and watch the run-through. I said, sure, why not? So someone had done a translation for him of the play, and he came in after lunch for the run-through. Very sweet, came in, walked over, sat down in the back of the space, and we proceeded to have the worst run-through I've ever been in a room with. Ellen was there, Bongo was there, Tom Hewitt, who met the other day, was there. Kelly was, did you hear Kelly?
Yes.
You remember that day?
I do.
It was horrible. It was terrible. And sit during rehearsal because I direct from here. So I was standing through the rehearsal and I started sweating and I kept seeing everything I'd done wrong. Like, why? What have I been doing in these rehearsals? That's wrong and that's wrong and that's wrong. And the actors were terrible and they were sweating. There sweetly, hardly looking at the stage, reading his translation. At the end of the rehearsal, he gets up and leaves. I think he probably said thank you for whatever. Anyway, he left. We were all in terrible moods. I cannot remember if I gave notes or what, but finally the rehearsal was over, and I went for a walk out in the open. And get some air with Leon Engelsrud. Where are you, Leon? And Leon at that time was a member of Suzuki's company, and he also was doing what Kenton's doing now, did it for 7 years. And so, but we were just beginning a friendship then. He was not in Orusti, so he had been there during it. And we went for a walk, and I said, God damn it, Leon, what just happened? Why is it that this guy comes into the rehearsal and everything goes wrong? And Leon said to me, one of the first lessons I learned, and it was one of many. He said, now get this right, Cameron. Leon said to me, well, I know what happened. He said, these actors have worked in one way or another with Suzuki-san. And when he's in rehearsal, he will say to an actor, a professional would see this in your work. I stopped, we were walking, I stopped and I went, oh. And I had this huge realization that as an American, I never, as a director, was looking from a point of view of a professional. I always look at, will Joe Schmo from Peoria get it? Do you know what I'm saying? I'm a populist. I'm a Democrat, in more ways than one. You getting that? I look at the stage from a different place. I look at it from a populist place. And these actors know, not so much because they talk about it, but they know that when Suzuki-san looks at the stage, he's looking at them from the point of view of a professional. And I thought, I could never say to an actor, a professional sees this. I need to say, well, it's got to be understandable by everyone. That was one of the first moments where I understood why I have spent my life wanting to go elsewhere outside of the United States in order to understand my own culture. And in that moment, it changed the way I walked into a rehearsal and the way I look at the stage. I start looking at the stage from a point of view of a professional, and that was the first thing. But the thing, and this is where the questions will come in, Cameron. What I encountered with Suzuki-san is that when he thinks about what a play is, he doesn't have the same idea I do. When he thinks what a rehearsal is, he has a completely different idea of what that is. When he thinks of what an audience is, he has a completely different idea. When he thinks about what an actor is and what an actor is to do, he has a completely different idea. So this morning, what I want to start talking about is exactly that question, is how do you, what is an actor? What is a play? What is an audience? They're really small questions. What is a rehearsal? I don't know if this is where you'd like to start with this, but the fundamental differences, which is, I think, when we saw the production last night, for those of us who were in the room, we felt that the air was changed by something. And I would propose to you that it's cultural in a way that's not a cliche. It's cultural in a way that the questions are different. The assumptions are different. So I'll finish by just saying that coming into contact with Suzuki-san and his company has had me question all of the assumptions that I inherited and then either say, well, I like mine, or I'm changing them. You know what I'm saying? It's not like I'm going to suddenly say I'm becoming Japanese, but it's saying, These assumptions are now in question. I actually do want to change the way I look at the stage, but there's other things that I don't want to change, but I own. So if you follow me, it's a different way to think of it. So I'm not sure, Suzuki-san, where you'd like to start.
But the first thing you should know is that he actually doesn't like the theater very much. He actually kind of hates it. So in Japan, in high school and in college, there are things called theater clubs. So, you know, there'd be men and women in these clubs together, and his general feeling of looking at these clubs was like, wow, they're just kind of sitting around, not really doing anything. So they, you know, they sit around, they read some European text, they talk about it a little bit, and that's kind of all they do. That was his impression. They thought maybe they're just goofing off, and not really doing anything. So he grew up actually in a house where they practiced Hidayu, which is the musical and vocal accompaniment to Bunraku, a puppet theater, a traditional form in Japan. And he actually hated this even more than the contemporary. So what happens, for example, is the musician sits in the middle of a room in seiza, strumming the shamisen. Everyone just sitting there alone making all these faces. He was just an elementary school student. He was forced to sort of sit in the room and watch this. Watch this. And he had to sit there for an hour. And he was terrified. If this is the real Japan, I really hate Japanese. So then he went on to high school, went on to college. So, and then he tried to do, you know, as far away from this kind of thing as he could. He sort of became a European intellectual.
We still had the jam, turn, 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 turn,
turn, turn, to classical music and writing his thoughts. He'd be sitting in cafes listening to classical music. So he really thought that theater is a waste of time. He really hated it.
So
his real focus early on was in the classics, right? In the plays and literature that came out of ancient Greece and the Romans and the Europeans following the Russian literature. He really followed that historically in his study. So the source of the Western lexicon of drama is Greek tragedy. Well, in France, of course, you have Racine, and you have Chekhov. And so there's a basic lexicon of books that you need to, and plays you need to read to understand Western, the base of Western theater.
その日本人、日本人の考えた場合に演劇をやると一番いいかもしれないと思う。
So he thought, in the course of his studies, the best way to、sort of deal with this Japan that he had grown to hate so much was to approach it through the lens of the Western canon.
演劇をやると日本という国は
Through the theater,
それだけじゃない。
he could understand Japan.
日本以外の国も。
And he could understand the countries outside of Japan.
その条件は3つあるんですね。
And his strategy for going about that had a three element.
それはニューヨークでは話しましたけれども、1つは言葉を使う。
And the first element, you talked about this in New York a little bit, was the use of language.
言葉っていうのは歴史性を持ってますから。
So in language, you have history.
それぞれの国のメンタリティ、それの歴史がよく分かる。
Within language, you have the mentality and the history of different peoples.
しかももう一つは、演劇やると体を使わなきゃいけない。
Then there's the physical aspect of the theater. You can't make theater without involving the body.
そうすると育ちとか環境とか遺伝子とかそれからまあですね、個人個人が持ってる古典的に育った環境とかね、そういうものによって人間って本当に違うんだってことはよく。
So looking at the body, you can see very clearly what makes people from different civilizations different. The way they were raised.Traditions they have, the kind of education they have, it all shows up in the body.
ですから一つの例えばバクテリアが入ったとしても病気の症状が現れたとは個人個人違いますね。
For example, if someone gets infected by a certain strain of bacteria, depending on their body, it will show up, it will manifest itself in different ways.
あるいは一つの事件が起きたときにそれへの判断力、対応、リアクションが違う。
And if there's any kind of If you have an accident, the way your body responds to that is different depending on your specific physical makeup.
その場合は体のアクションですよ。
Physical action.
体に出てくる反応です。それからもう一つ言うことは、集団でやんなきゃいけないらしいってことは分かった。劇曲を読んで。
So, language, the body, and the group.
で、まあ一人で物事を考えてるって言ったらこれ想像力。一人の想像力ですね。
So,You know, when you have the impulse to be creative, it's something you do on your own, you imagine
something.
So perhaps the easiest group to sort of imagine is a couple, two lovers. They're very easily able to come up with a shared vision of something.
これは非常に共通の目的と共通のイメージを持つことが難しくなります。で、数が増えるわけ。
But basically, when you have groups that involve three people or more, it starts to become more complicated. How do you decide on rules that everyone's going to agree on?
ですから、国家は国家がいい。
And that's sort of the way the idea of nation begins, starting with three.
2人までは数。
So, a family in a way is the beginning.
3人になってくると、以上になってくると、国家的な何が必要かというルールが必要。
So, if you think of family, if you think of nation, for it to function, you need a rule.
で、このルールは誰が作るのか、誰が作ったのか、誰が作るのかということがとても面白いんじゃないかと思った。
And so, in his thinking about this, he thought, well,How these rules get arrived at, who decided them, who will decide them, that seems to be at the crux of how these groups are made and maintained.
演劇をやると、この3つのことにどうしてもこう関わらなきゃいけない。あるいは接触しなきゃいけない。理解しなきゃいけない。言葉、体、グループ、ルールですね。
And so as he started to think about the theater, he focused more and more on these three aspects. Now, how do I deal with language?Ready with the body, how do I sustain a group?
それで、もしこれをやりますと、日本とは何か、日本人のメンタリティは何かということだっただけじゃなくて、アメリカ人のメンタリティが、アメリカっていう国はどういう国か、それから演劇やフランスっていう国はどういう国かっていうのが分かる。
So you can use, or you started to use this troika of elements and lenses to not just examine his own culture and country, but to look at America, to look at France, to see by having the same lens how different cultures showed up. So if you read Dostoevsky or you read Kafka, you get a good idea of those individual points of view. And it's true with contemporary authors too, right? By looking at this individual's perspective, you can get a sense of their ideas, but it's more complicated to get the bigger picture. What is the whole context in which this person wrote? What is the national context? What is the cultural context that this came out of? It's harder to get a sense of that just from reading. And in the theater, however, you're working with a group of people, a theater company. So right away what happens when you start to make a group is you start to have rules and you see right away who is attracted to those rules, who starts to work against those rules, who commits to them, who drops out. It becomes clear pretty quickly. So you look at politics, this is pretty clear, right? You can see the kinds of folks who agree with Trump's rules. They're really decisive,
right?
And in China you have the Communist Party, the people that really follow the party line. So it becomes about who controls those rules. So in the managing and directing of a theater company, it also becomes quite clear. It's also true for a ballet troupe or a symphony orchestra. You can look at the rules that either of these forms or these groups have and think, what is the history of these rules? Who's decided these rules over time? And that was attractive to me. And the reason for that is it's not enough just to think about yourself, right? You have to think about the other. What is the other perspective? How can I see things from a different perspective? So, just to respond to Anne's question about what's my first impulse in choosing a text, for
example.
So, as he said before, I hated Japan. It wasn't just that he hated Japanese theater or theater people. He also hated the politician. He hated the social system. That was his base feeling just about towards
everything.
Well, not everything. It was that there were certain things that really
bugged.
So now when he thinks back to his uncle playing the shamisen, making all the gidayun performance in front of him, he thinks, wow, my uncle was really great. put this little elementary school kid in front of me, put all of his heart into showing me this thing that he knew I would never understand.
小さい部屋でモーツァルト聴きながら議論しているやつらも日本にない音楽を聴こうとしてなんか一生懸命刺激を受けようとしてたからまあいいんだなとかっていう程度には私も大人になった。
They would put him in a room and make him listen to Mozart and talk about the effect it was having on him, and he thought, oh, these are really great things that they made me do. It helped me become an adult.
ただし最初私はともかく人に興味を持っているのでこういうふうな考え方私はこういうふうに世界を考えるあるいは日本を考えるんだけどあなたたちこういう考え方を共有してくれますかそれから変わってくれますかっていうのが最初の欲求なんだよ。
So the thing that really hooked himwas this idea of, I have my worldview, I have the things I believe, but what happens when I talk to you, and you have a different perspective, but how can we come together and form a shared perspective? He was really interested in the process through which that could happen.
で、それは精神的なものだけじゃなくて、行動も含めて、行動でも示した。
It wasn't just a spiritual concern, it was also about action.
だから山の中行ったんです。
That's why he ended up going into the mountains.
要するに、どんどんどんどん日本は今、東京に人口が集中してたんですね。
And in Japan, for the years, especially when he was growing up, there was this exodus from the country into the city.
私がトランペット、ジャパンシティの日本海側はどんどん混んでいく。
On the west coast of Japan, along the Japan Sea, most of the people living in this part of the country migrated towards the east, towards the urban centers. And he thought, we need to do something about it. We can't just all live in the city. How do we bring life back into these abandoned parts of the country?
なぜこんなことが起こるかというと、さっき言ったように、言葉とか誰だとか集団のルールが過去にね日本の伝統と呼ばれるものがこういう傾向に作用してるんじゃないかっていうことでそれに攻撃をしなきゃいけないっていうことで大体そういうふうにテキストをこう選んでる。
He thought this exodus into the urban centers was going to over the long run damage the richhistory, legacy of Japanese culture. He thought, well, I've got to do something to stem that trend. I've got to work against that to somehow create something new and hold on to our history, hold on to
legacy.
So in the case of Trojan Women, which you saw
this,
it wasn't only the protagonist, isn't only an old Japanese woman after World War II. It's not limited to that interpretation. Japan invaded China, for example, destroyed
Korea.
Japan made a colony of Korea during the war.
そういう意味では、アジアで植民地にならなかった唯一の国は、戦争はアメリカに負けましたけれども、植民地になった国は日本。
So until, and really, Japan has never been a colony, right? Even though we had the occupying forces there after World War II, it's one of the only countries in Asia, East Asia, that has not been colonized. But it was extremely down and out in those years immediately following
the war.
And there was a kind of attempt to forget the past, forget memory. And he was saying, no, we have to very deliberately, you know, interrogate and continue to examine what's happened. So it wasn't just a comment on the misery of Japan after World War II, it was we have to work hard so that this doesn't happen again. We need to continue to interrogate the issues that caused this to happen in the
first place. それともう一つその時に、その時に日本の宗教界っていうのは全然無力だった。
And so at that time, the, you know, the religious sort of environment in Japan was also not, didn't have power, didn't have the power to keep the tradition, right?
これは第二次大戦の時のバチカンのものです。
It's a little bit, you know, the way the Vatican operated right after World War II as well,
right?
There's a, many of you may know the story of the Vatican not necessarily being against what the Nazis were doing and being the ones who allowed many of them to escape to South America.
ただ一方ではあれでいいんだって考えたと思って、宗教っていうものが宗教の名のもとに行動を起こすと共に持ってきたんだことになるということもあります。
So you couldn't really depend on the religious organizations, religious structures to hold the cultures together, to hold the ideals together either.
それはイエスの言葉。
And then you have extremism that happens as well, and then you can see that now in ISIS.
ですから私の世界的なものの見方で今これをやったらいいっていうことで大体テキストを選んでいくと。
So as a way to keep interrogating this issue of why this extreme, this religious extremism continues to have this damaging effect, any kind of extremism has a damaging effect, those issues are treated very clearly and directly in this play.
例えばリアをやった時にはあのレーガンだった。
When he did Tale of Lear in the 80s, Reagan. And it was family values was a catchphrase. And at the time there was a, you know, there was family structure was sort of falling apart in Japan. So it, you know, previously you'd have three generations living in a single house. Then that system was breaking down so that you'd start to have, you know, nuclear families. Just you'd have two generations or just one generation. So this idea of fighting over inheritance, like, you know, the family conflict, it's what drove him to choose King Lear and also to choose Electra. And to examine family conflict, he thought using the classics was a good, using tradition was a good. The reason to use the classics and to use traditional forms is a way to reinforce this idea that human beings don't really change. If you look at the Trojan women, you know, the Trojans completely lost that war, they were destroyed. All of the Trojan warriors, the males, were killed. And the, all of the castle completely leveled to the ground. It wasn't an occupation, it was a complete annihilation. And destruction of the entire race of people. This idea of genocide, of wiping out an entire race of people, you can see now also in the rhetoric of ISIS.
Right?
So religious extremism has this rhetoric built into it, right? The complete annihilation of the other. The other is called evil, and so it gives you permission to annihilate.
ですが変えたっていうところがすごいんです。
But the real, again, hook for him was beyond the narrative, was the fact that Eurymedes, who was from the winning side, chose to write this. It wasn't a Trojan author, it was the winner who said, we have to look at
the winning side. The winning side の人が敵対する国の女王を主人公にして戦争を批判したっていうところが、これがすごいんです。素晴らしい。
He thought Euripides chose the queen of the losing side as the protagonist and the lens through which to talk about this historical event. That's amazing. I want to do that.
私は演劇っていうのはこういう意味でいつも批判的な知性、批判的な知性を持った人でいつも戦ってきた人だっていうことを、日本以外の演劇を勉強して学びましたね。
So he realized that what it means to be a theater person, going all the way back to Euripides, is to have this spirit of interrogating the status quo, of always intellectually looking at what's happening and questioning it, and that's what pulled him into it.
ですからまあこれ人にしてもインクセンにしてもそのあるいはサミラーにしても
そう、look at Brecht, you look at Arthur Miller, you look at Ibsen, they've all had this way to interrogate what's going on.
政治的権力とは少し
And eventually what happens when you do this is you start to have conflict with those in power.
Euripides もちょ
っと聞こうだな。You know, was in many ways punished for his points of view.
you bring up the huge word, which is the other. You say making the other evil. And Euripides is engagement with the other, the side that was defeated. And I'm so thrilled in a way to hear you talk about your own dissatisfaction as a young director, a young person in Japan, or as Martha Graham called it, divine dissatisfaction. And the fact that you looked to the literature and to Europe and other places as a way of looking back at your own civilization, at your own culture. And I believe in that as well. In order to look at, say, an American culture, I have to look at it through the lens of the other. And that seems to be the fundamental job of the artist, but also subject matter right now because of the current change in not only the administration here with Trump, but also with Duterte and Erdogan and Hungary, Orban. That the issue of the other and the demonization of the other is a big deal. And so I want to look at the moment. I want to look at the moment, Suzuki-san, when you as a young director and your company went to France for the first time and your work was discovered by friends and really celebrated, and Jean-Louis Barrault said this is the work to pay attention to. Something happened to you in that moment as a director, as an artist in the world, and I think you came back to Japan in a different way. And I wonder if you could describe that trip, if you could describe going to France, performing Trojan Women 40 years ago, and something happened. What was that?
あの、三つありますね。
We have another three main points to talk
about.
So, of course, Jean-Louis Barrault was the famous mime and producer. He was a leader in the French theater of that time in the
1600s.
He had seen his training quite a bit, Suzuki's training. And he invited Suzuki various times. It was, the festival was called the Theater of Nations, which was
a...
It was groups from over 50 countries invited to France to do a big international festival, which happened for in the 60s and 70s.
その時に驚いたのは、こう、これぐらいのスペースだ
The thing that most surprised him was the theater that he performed in. It was a space about this big.
ただし四角で、
it was square.
それ普通の人が住んでたアパート。
And it was actually previously an apartment.
それでこう円形になってたんです。
And then they had made a kind of circular state within this square.
私は32歳だ。
He was 32.
それで、その客席がベニヤ持ったんです。
And the audience seats were just basically plastic sheets. And they put some cushions on top. His image of having a part of a French theater festival was he'd be in the opera of Paris with thousands of seats and this amazing velvet curtains. And so the Japanese government gave him a lot of money, and he sort of had these expectations going into it.
It
looked like a sort of low-grade pro wrestling. And all of the company arrived and they were all psyched, and then they saw the space and they were and they're like, so this is the state of the theater in France. This is a French theater. So I was, first of all, I was shocked. And so, he went to find the artistic director Jean-Louis Barrault's office, and it was like in this beat up old, what was the kitchen in this
apartment.
And so he said, I'm waiting for you in my office, please come. So he went. So it was a kitchen, and there was a little cot in the corner. And he was over there taking a nap when he came in. He thought, so this is the leader of French theater? He thought, oh, well, this is just the assistant of the assistant who's going to meet me here and then take me to meet Jean-Louis
Barrault.
But then he hopped up out of the car and said, oh, nice to meet you, brother. And the other big shock for him was the complexity and the diversity of the audience. Many different races, many different cultures represented. Not just European diversity, people from Africa, people from Arabia. Wherever you go in Japan, the audience will only be Japanese. If you ride the subway, it's hard to find someone who's not Japanese. And so suddenly, being in front of so many different nationalities and races was a shock.
そこでそういうところの最前列の前にグルトスキーがこうなって座ってたり、ピーター・ブルックがいたり、ブルースキーがいたりしてるわけです。
And it, there on those veneer seats, he saw the French Minister of Culture, and Jerzy Grotowski, and Raymond Mushkin, and Peter Brook. They were all there on the plastic. They didn't even have seats. They were just on little cushions, like you guys are. He was impressed. So if this was the theater, for example, imagine that the audience we had last night was stacked up until the very edge of the stage. You couldn't fit another soul in this place. He thought, well, could you please not seat any more people actually on the stage? and then Jean-Louis Barrault comes in and he's like nailing down a little barrier. Got some nails and some spare wood and he starts to square. degree of intimacy that this space And in that moment, you realize it's not that they don't have money. They want to create this kind of experience. It was an attitude of, you don't like this kind of theater? Well, there's the door. So, you know, John Liberal came out, he had his nail can, he had his hammer. He not only made this, he made a few hanamichi, right? Little aisles that the actors could enter through. He was there standing alongside Mr. Suzuki. Normally, you'd have a director yelling at all of the staff and actors to do all this work, but he was doing it. And he was amazed at the potential of the human being. He thought, human beings can go this far. He thought, wow, in this life, you could meet amazing people if you try. And he saw this kind of person in John Wei Barrow, and he was completely inspired by his spirit. And also with you. He thought, you also were one of these. When you first met. He thought you were a little bit like a Timmy. It was back through TCG.
Something happened.
But when he had those first meetings with TCG, that was the first time.
I did go to Woodstock.
That was, yeah, he's not surprised. Yeah, there's some weirdos in the United States, that's for sure.
This space, you've transformed completely. And those of us in this room, I see Larry Opitz over there, who's been in here a lot. Have you seen this space like this before?
No one's going to use it next year.
Yeah, you cannot. For those of you who've not been in this room before, this space is completely transformed. It was very theater unfriendly in some ways until Suzuki-san and his company came in and transformed it into this, where suddenly the relationship between the actors and the audience is very intimate, and you were talking about learning about intimacy. And you developed a relationship with Isozaki, the great Japanese architect, and have made many, many buildings in Japan that are essentially audience actor friendly. And the only other person I know who thinks that way is the French designer who works with Peter Brook, what's his name? Jean-Guy Lecat, who also thinks about the stage's relationship to the human being in relationship to the audience. And so I have two questions. One, how did you come upon this plan of transforming this space here, because it's completely different? And two, what can you describe your relationship with Mr. Isozaki and your thoughts about space and theater and actors?
So when he first came in, there were the blacks hung all across the space, and the wings and behind the back wall. And he realized that the quality of the curtains and of the wall here all were
different.
And the lighting instruments and the way he uses them are very focused, high intensity, to create a high level of contrast. And because of the way he is with the body and he's close to the ground, oftentimes the angle of the face is a bit down. If you only use lights above, your face becomes in shadow, so you have to use shin busters.
このサイドのライトがうるさく出ないようにしないするってことが大事なんです。
And one of the things he has to consider, since he needs to use side light and shin busters, is how do you make the instruments less present for the audience?
そうすると、同じように行ったときに、こういうコンクリートのライト、布では全く出てくる感じが違うの、光が。
So, because you're using shin busters, shadow becomes an important element. And the way you see shadow, the way it reflects off the wall, is quite different if you're using a curtain versus just on a plain wall.
ですから本当は全部まだちょっと残ってるんですが、これは照明で見えないようにできると思ったんですよね。今後
で。So that's when we've sort of hidden the lights behind.
できたら何もないのはこの空間には。
But he thought right away, the best thing is to try to strip.As much as possible, so that the shadow has the most. And that way, it actually makes it easier. There's more fluidity to the space. It's easier to begin and enter.
で、私の考え方は、建築した時に、その建築物そのものがもう装置だって。
His thinking about being in a theater building is you have to use the architectural qualities that are already there. You have to use what's excellent.
ですから、私の戸村には5つ劇場がありますけど、装置は作ったことないんですね。
So he's got 5 theaters in Toga, but he almost never builds a set.
で、だけどそういうことを考える建築家はいないんですよ。
But there are very few architects who will think like this.
建築としての自分の主張をまずやっちゃう。
They want to show off their ideas, their design.
ただ磯崎っていうのは私の友達でしたので、私が大体こう図面描いて、渡して、あとこれをちゃんとしてくれるっていう関係だから。
But Isozaki, Arata, and Suzuki were good friends, and their collaboration was Suzuki would make some sketches, hand them over to Isozaki, and Isozaki would come back with architectural drawing.
まあ気に入らないと色を変え、自分で私が勝手に塗っても言わない関係だから。
And he also lets him, you know, mess up his building if he needs to. He can paint on it, he can do whatever. Probably if he suddenly was given this theater, he'd start changing the painting on the sort of the white walls there and the columns.
What would he paint? He'd paint something
different. He drew something so that the white border there wasn't quite as
dark.
He tried to maybe make it look more metallic, dark metal gray. So that the quality between this space and that is just subtly different.
そうすると私はこうやってこうなった時にあれがスーッとこう入ります。
So that when you stand on the stage, from the actor's point of view, you can sort of you can feel more clearly the presence of this spring space on your body.
このブリッジの雰囲気とあれが違う。
So the feeling you get looking at the catwalk versus the feeling you get looking at this white border is different.Maybe the audience doesn't notice this, but the actor does. So somehow to create a more specific relationship between that part of the space. So I start to become really obsessed with these kinds of things.
この照明なんだとか、このスタンドの場所が違うとか、そういうことを考えちゃうから、人のうちに招待されると辛いんです。
It's one of the side effects of being a director. You get invited to somebody's house and right away you're like, why did they put that light up there? They hang that curtain there. And like, so he actually never takes an invitation to his house. And he really has a hard time producing in other people's theaters. But here he was lucky and he was able to find a solution. Thank you for letting us.
I think you've made this theater yours from now on. It's going to be called the Suzuki Tadashi Theater. Now, I'm going to ask just one or two more questions, and then I'd like to open it up, so get ready to ask questions, ladies and gents. The members of the symposium 2 nights ago came to a rehearsal of Trojan Women, and you said to the assembled who was here for the rehearsal, you said, "Don't get upset if I yell. I'm not yelling at you, I'm yelling at the actors." And it's your relationship with actors is very particular. And the first time I saw you actually rehearse was in Mito, when you were actually in rehearsal. And you would clap, and everyone on the stage stopped and had to hold their position while you worked with one actor in a loud voice for a very long time. And afterwards, I asked one of the actors what they thought of having to hold their position for so long. Really, like 20 minutes. It felt like 20 minutes. And how it was. And I also asked this person why it is, because they were, Ellen and Kelly were on stage in that time. It was for Dionysus. And I asked why Suzuki doesn't yell at American actors. He seemed to yell at the Japanese actors. And the answer that I got back was twofold. First, about holding position for a long time. The actor I spoke with said, "It's actually great, because for 20 minutes, I'm living with the mistake I probably made." And I'll never make that mistake. And number two, and I found this fascinating, and I wonder if you think this is true, that what Suzuki was looking for with the Japanese actors, the American actors could do already. It was that he was asking them to differentiate themselves from one from another. Again, it's a cultural issue. That Americans don't have a problem being different from each other on the stage, do you follow me? But that he was trying to get the Japanese actors to actually differentiate one from the other. So my questions are about your relationship to actors.
He's not really yelling at actors. he's passionately making raising the
bar.
So the reason why he wasn't giving any notes to Kelly and Ellen was, you know, he doesn't speak English. If he was fluent, it could go on for hours. So whenever there was a time for notes for Ellen or Kelly, it was like, okay, let's take a break, and then he would just focus on that. It would take more time.
So
if you look at Kareon, the famous conductor, maybe there's some similarity. You know, he's one of these conductors that when he's working on opera, he'll get up from the orchestra pit or wherever he's working, he'll start dancing, start moving, you know, on stage. And also, Mr. Suzuki oftentimes will go out and show an actor with his own body. But he would have to do it with Kelly and Ellen because he couldn't tell it. And then later he would go out in a separate place with a translator. very sort of carefully explain to them what was going on wrong. And then he could just say, well, if the acting's no good, then it must have been a problem with the translation. And then if it goes well, then he took the credit. So that was, he had many experiences like that. So, anyway, it becomes the translator's fault.
I brought this up to Ellen yesterday, and she said, no, you know, actually the way he speaks with each actor is very, very, very different. It might sound to me like yelling, but it's actually extremely different. So, say you're in rehearsal, you're working with an actor, you approach them, how do you adjust?
So, because he himself trained his body as an actor, he has become quite adept at being able to see in other bodies too where there's a problem. So this actor could be able to move very quickly across the space and keep this level. This other actor could be able to stand up very quickly. He can see the abilities, the special abilities, differently in each person. So his process of rehearsal is he lets them work on their own for a time, right? Learning the choreography, learning
the.
And so when he sees something that isn't quite right, doesn't have the quality that he's searching for, he'll get up and show
himself.
And because he's in toga, he's not limited in any way by time and space. He can be there as long as he needs to be until an actor really starts to get what he's looking for. They're all government facilities in toga. They're owned by the
prefecture.
And so all of the government workers, the people that administer the Toga Arts Park, they all go home at 5. They go home at 5, but he has all the keys. He's got a keychain like this. So often what he'll do is he'll give an outline. He'll let them work on it. And then when they're ready, or when he thinks they should be ready, he'll show up and see how it goes.
ただその時にね、昨日これはニューヨークで説明したんですけど、お米がありますよね。お米を炊きますよね。
そ
うネバネバします。
For to make an illusion is a little bit like cooking rice.
お米自体はネバネバしてるから、炊きますよね。
So when you're cooking sushi rice, right, the rice sticks together.
それで大きいお米もあれば小さいお米もあるし。
Not all rice.Grains are the same. Some are big, some are small. Stick together. So depending on how they're shaped, sometimes they get stickier or less sticky. But anyway, they all make a big glob at the end. So you stick together. So you end up getting stuck together, but the shape doesn't look so nice. That's So in order for it to become a nice roll, you need a sheet of nori seaweed that you can put around it to give it, to contain it.
この森巻が鈴木トレーニング、鈴木メイトという、
And so that nori is the grammar of the Suzuki method, and that's what creates the form. And then everybody sticks together.
I was wondering where you were going.
So the creation of a method is needed to contain the actors, right? If it's not there, you see that it's ripped, right? You see that it's loose or wet or soggy. It doesn't keep the shape and the form. So for example, they'll often ask an actor to move across the space, keeping their center at the same height, right? But if their nori is not in good shape, they'll float up and down and it'll look kind of messy.
So
that's
what
So he has certain rules that are created by the grammar, but then he also tries to let there be freedom within that structure.
So why do we emphasize this? In America, it's also the same. If you have a dictator, tyrant,
So what he really wants to do is kind of go make sure you all understand that. Image that sometimes is out there in the world about Mr. Suzuki, that he's a tyrant, that he's abusive, all of these things, he really wants to set the record straight. So when an actress in Jean-Louis Barrault's company saw him working, the actors in the 60s when he was bringing the Trojan women to the Theater of Nations, she asked him, Mr. Suzuki, when did you become a feminist? So he's not a feminist, he's not any of these things that have a label, right?
Maybe chauvinist pink is not.
And he's not, nor is he a male chauvinist pink.
This is the time where we're going to open this up for questions, if anybody has any. Yes, and if you would introduce yourself and... great, there's microphones are calling.
Suzuki-san, hajimimashite. Azuma des, dozo yoroshiku onegashimasu. And, good evening, I'm Dominic Page from Montreal, Canada. Mr. Suzuki, I saw the show yesterday. I'd like to first thank you, and please ask you to, on my behalf, congratulate the whole team. I have two questions. You've always promoted international collaboration, cross-pollination. You yourself having gone to the West. My two questions that touch on that. The first one being, I'd like you to talk a bit about your relationship with Tadeusz Kantor from Poland, how perhaps he has irrigated your activities in Japan, and maybe if he has brought you to Eastern Europe. First question. Second question, concerning your current endeavor of producing shows in China. Now, historically and currently, obviously, can you please talk about, for example, the circumstances now in China? We understand that there has been a certain animosity toward Japanese, which is promoted maybe by the Chinese government or anyway kept alive. How are you dealing with that? What is your relationship? And what is the reception of your work in China. Thank you.
あの優れた芸術家っていうのはみんなファウンダーなんですよ。
So if you look at history, the greatest theater artists are ones that found something.
だいたい突然こう出てくる。
And sometimes a founder appears suddenly in a culture.
それで優れた芸術家っていうのは他人影響を受けるということじゃなくて、他人のいいところを盗むのが上手いんです。
So the great, great artists aren't influenced by other artists. They look very carefully at what another artist is doing and then steal it.
ピカソの絵なんてほとんど溶接だって。
Most of Picasso's work somehow are stolen. The ideas are.
優れた建築はもう全部そうです。
All of the great architecture functions.
過去の遺産の例は。
They make references to the classic.
それは新しい関係の中にしてここにおるじゃない。
What makes them creative is the fact that they are the dialogue with them happens now in the time we.
ですからロバート・ジョンソンとかね、ピーター・ブルックとかパントムとかいつも演劇祭で私は一緒ですから。
So for a long time, you know, people like Robert Wilson and Cantor and Peter Brook, they were all invited to the same festivals more or less at the same time for a period there.
それは全然違うんですよ。カントルの芝居とも、ロバート・ジョンソンの芝居とも私は違うんでしょう。
So, as you can tell, you've seen, my work's very different from theirs.
似てるところはある
んです。I mean, you can see points of commonality.
ロバート・ジョンソンも照明に凝るんです。
There's Bob is also crazy about light.
こういう手一つで照明やる。
You know, he has a hand in space and he, you know, spends hours trying to light just the hand, for example. It takes a whole day of rehearsal just to
light
that hand. And the way the sight is slowly modulating, that takes hours and days to, you know, plan the lighting design for that. Bob's in Robert Wilson's.
カントルは役者がいるときに舞台に出てて、どうなって、一緒になって、音楽がドバーッとやって。
And Cantor would get up on stage with the actors and yell at them and start directing them, and that's sort of one of the tricks he used.
私のときで、稽古のときは真似します。
And he imitates that during rehearsal, he'll get up there.
芝居は全然違う。
Usually doesn't do that during.
ユリネメモブっていう人は最高列にいて、すごい強い懐中電灯を持ってる。
Yuri Lubimov would sit in the audience with a really strong flashlight and shine it. Every time it's not going well in a performance, he'd shine it right at the end. And if it's going in a circle, it means pick up pace. He'd be sitting next to him during a show, and
he'd have a flashlight. やめてくれって言うんだけど、やめないって言うわけ、リビンも。まあ、鈴木からやめるように言ってくれって、鈴木が言えば聞くかもしれない。
So, you know, he was saying, you know, Suzuki said, could you cut out the flashlight, please, a little bit? He's like, well, if you ask me to, maybe I will.
だから、例えばリビンの方がダメな時に懐中電灯を加えたいっていう、こう気持ちはわかるんです。
But anyway, he really understands the feeling you get as a director of wanting to shine a flashlight on the actor when they're messing it up. And so he started to think, well, what can I use instead of a flashlight that would be as effective? So, you know, during a live performance with an audience, he didn't really want to pull out a flashlight, so he started getting different kinds of calls. So there'd be like a code language to the call. So you're overdoing it a little, for example. So he would, you know, sort of maybe, you know, he'd like maybe spit a little bit on the audience in front of him.
だからまあ、だから競争してるってね。
So all of these, you know, we're competing with these, where there's a competition going on between So he's taking issue with this idea of being influenced by another great artist. It's more, you're in competition with all these great artists, and you're going to observe their strategies, and you're going to take what's useful to you. So it's, you can be influenced by other... You can be influenced by humans. You can see an individual's quality of concentration and be influenced by that. He was working with Rostropovich, the cellist, and he was sitting there watching the quality of concentration he had when he was playing, for example. And he tried breathing with Rostropovich as he was playing the cello. And so in that way, you can have a dialogue with other art forms and then use that in the creation of the theater. And then there's the Japanese flute made out of bamboo called the shakuhachi. They have different ways of breathing, ways that they create a resistance in their throat with the breath, so that different qualities of sound. And if you have, like out of a hose, a stream of water rushing out, if you grab the edge of the hose, a very thin stream can come up very quickly. So in the same way, the air going through the windpipe when you're playing shakuhachi changes. If you squeeze the throat and make it a very thin line of air, the sound changes, for example. Having it open. And then he uses that on the stage. What happens if you make a small hole versus open? So studying the way these musicians play and the way they breathe, and then use that in the way you work with actors. He doesn't know if that is good to call that influence necessarily. He's studying something, repurposing. Maybe you're familiar with the author Yukio Mishima. He writes manuscripts. And what he does is he writes three pages and then right away he throws them away. And then there's another author, Kenzaburo Obe, right? He writes about 700 pages stream of consciousness.
Right?
And then he cuts about a third. And so he sees the way these writers work, for example. He sees their process. So, for example, when he was working on the lower depths, and to use that same. From Kenzaburo Oe, he took that same strategy and used it when he directed Gorky's The Lower Depths. He had the actors do the whole thing, and then he meditated on that and decided what he didn't need. So looking at different people's qualities of concentration, different human beings' passions, the way a politician gets passionate in his speech, looking at those qualities and then figuring out how to repurpose them in creation of theater. Of course he has tastes scripts that he likes and he doesn't like, but it's not that he's necessarily influenced
by
and one of the, again, it's about process. He steals from other people's processes. Mishima Yukio every day, always, 3 hours, right? And even if he doesn't write, he's just sitting there thinking about it. That kind of discipline, artistic discipline for your work. And so what he does, if an actor's really not going the right direction, he'll sit with them for 3 hours.
So
this is when it's not going well. Sit with them. Work. So what you could say is what he's really borrowing or is influenced by is his attitudes toward the work. He looks at these different professionals in the world and sees their process and he's like, well, I like that because it reinforces an idea I have about the way of working.
中国については言えばですね、中国は要するに伝統があるんです。So
now to talk about China, of course China has a very long tradition.
しかし中国今の中国とかですからまだ40年、数十年。But
really when you talk about China, we're talking about 40 years. But before the current era, you had a different dynasty, you had a completely different set of values. In China, when the dynasty changes, the whole social makeup of the whole nation shifts. In that way, it's different from
Japan.
But if you look at in ancient China, in the times when, for example, the Great Wall was built, there's points of commonality and great ideas toward civilization that you might also when you look at the Greeks. That legacy is in. But then you had the Cultural Revolution. And everything that was thought of as Chinese tradition was fundamentally destroyed. And now we have a time when there is an incredible upward movement, and there's also a military movement that's increasing.
Globalization no context.
And they have become a global player. So when you become a global player, national identity becomes a very important issue. So just being a rich country and just being powerful in a military sense isn't enough to create an identity.
やっぱりこれはともかくギリギリシャでも何でもヨーロッパもすごいのはヨーロッパがまだね発揮してたとしてもそこにいたとかあるでしょ川口のしかしまだこの川口が光ってるのはやっぱりそれは文化の力だよね。So
for example we have in Europe a sense of maintaining a kind of continuity with culture. A constant re-examining and keeping culture alive and vibrant in the everyday. That's lasted a long time. Even if the pair of shoes you're wearing is very old and it's been around for centuries, you keep polishing, you keep using it in a new way. So when you look at an old pair of shoes, you can see sort of where they've walked, what parts worn out, right? So if you look at a European shoe, there's parts that are worn based on the history. There's still a little bit of polish left. But right now in China, there's no shoe. They have to make a shoe. But there's 1.3 billion people. And the current form of government is state capitalism. And because it's state capitalism, it can very radically shift on the, you know, from one day to the next. So every year in Toga, we have, every year in Beijing, we have now from all over the country, different people coming together to study his method. And there is a sort of Chinese version of Tom Hewitt that he's encountered, and he's really focusing a lot of his attention on him now to be the next protagonist in this Chinese And it feels like, you know, with all the work he's doing in China to build something, it's actually having an effect on this national effort to create Shu. So there's, you know, obviously the Communist Party, there's millions and millions of people in the party officially, sort of an official status. And those party members have a pretty firm grip on everything that's going on.
Thank you.
There's no election, right, like in the United States. And so we have a situation which is, if you look at the history of the world, it's new. You have basically a one-party system that is focused on capitalism. And they're trying very hard to just focus on growth, and identity. Within the American capitalist system, the power of the people is very important. The difference of opinions. The dialogue is an important part of our way we define ourselves. Whereas there, it's the party line. So to have a relationship with U.S. capitalism, to have a relationship with state capitalism in China, it's interesting to see how these things are playing out in a different way.
Believe it or not, that was the Q&A section. Yeah. Before ending this, I want to first of all thank Suzuki-san and his entire company for coming all the way to Saratoga.
So the fact that 25 years ago Mr. Suzuki came and built this company and that it has lasted to today, you think this is now an important part of your United States heritage, and it really is important that it continues, a place where people from all over the world forget.
ますます力を注いで、ここが盛り上がるようにしていただけると。
So at this time in the world, when there's so much upheaval, the fact that all of you participants and people that support the City Company have come to share this space with us, he's very grateful for your time.
This entire thing up, Ellen Lauren.
Thank you.
So many of you are here ending this unique once in a lifetime, because you can only do it the first time once. And I wanted to take a moment to acknowledge that, and with all my heart, on behalf of all my company members, thank you for making this pilgrimage, making this possible. This event was powered by you and made extraordinary by you. And I think we have our marching orders here to go back to our communities, as Barney said, drop that line and let those waves span out as far as they can. Go home with hope and encouragement. The City Company was always told when we got tired and needed to refresh that TOGA was there for us. And it's our charge now in turn to say to you, when you get tired and you need refreshment, you need a spiritual boost, you need to work hard with your body, your mind, and your spirit, that the City Company will do everything we can to provide you with a sanctuary and refuge for that. Stay close to us, to one another, and I officially, there will be, oh yes, well, he said he will sign books. There's a lot of you that probably want that to happen. So if he signs so many and then gets very tired, he does have a long day of rehearsal and performance, so please understand. But he will be out in the lobby, I hope, he promised. And as you can see, a pretty extraordinary mind who has reverberated and, as we had hoped, transformed us all. So thank you. This is officially coming to close.